We're going to drop off the formalities and let him, inshallah, start. Jazakumullah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlil fala hadiya lahu. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار Alhamdulillah, we praise Allah and we seek His assistance and we seek His forgiveness. And we seek refuge in Allah from the evil within ourselves and from our bad deeds. However Allah guides, there is none that can lead Him astray. And whoever is led astray, then there is no guide for him. I bear witness that no God has the right to be worshipped other than Allah. He is alone and has no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad is His slave and His messenger. O you who believe, fear Allah as you ought to be feared and don't die except as Muslims. O humanity, fear your Lord who has created you from a single soul and created from it its mate and scattered from them too many men and women. And fear Allah for you demand your mutual rights and don't cut off relations with the wombs that bore you. Indeed, Allah is a raqib over you. O you who believe, fear Allah and say that which is correct in order that He may accept from you your deeds and forgive you of your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His messenger achieves the greatest achievement, amma ba'du. Certainly the most truthful speech is the book of Allah. And the finest guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the most evil of affairs are newly invented matters in this deen. And every newly invented matter in this deen is a bid'ah. And every bid'ah is a straying, and every straying is in the fire. This morning's talk, the priorities of learning the knowledge. We want to take a look at a chapter from the chapters of Kitab al-Ilm by Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah in al-Sahih. Where Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says, بَابُ الْعِلْمُ قَبْلَ الْقَوْلِ وَالْعَمَلِ لِقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى فَعَلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ فَبَدَأَ بِالْعِلْمِ وَأَنَّ الْعُلَمَاءَ هُمْ وَرَثَةُ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ وَرَّثُ الْعِلْمِ مَنْ أَخَذَهُ أَخَذَ بِحَظٍ وَافِرٍ وَمَنْ سَلَكَ طَرِيقًا يَطْلُبُ بِهِ عِلْمًا سَهَلَ اللَّهُ لَهُ طَرِيقًا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ وَقَالَ جَلَّ ذِكْرُهُ إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء وقال وما يعقلها إلا العالمون وقالوا لو كنا نسمع أو نعقل ما كنا في أصحاب السعير وقال هل يستوي الذين يعلمون والذين لا يعلمون وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من يرد الله به خيرا يفقهه وإنما العلم بالتعلم وقال أبو ذر رضي الله عنه لو وضعتم الصمصامة على هذه وأشار إلى قفاه ثم ظننت أني أنفذ كلمة سمعتها من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قبل أن تجيزوا علي لأنفذتها وقال ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما كونوا ربانيين حلماء فقهاء ويقال الرباني الذي يربي الناس بصغار العلم قبل كباره. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says, chapter knowledge or al-ilm is before statements and actions. And that is because of the statement of Allah Ta'ala, I command you to have knowledge that no God has the right to be worshipped except Allah. And indeed, he began with knowledge. And indeed the ulama, they are those who left knowledge to be inherited from them. And whoever gets this knowledge, then he has a large portion. And whoever treads a path, seeking in that path knowledge, then Allah would make easy for him the path to Jannah. And Allah Ta'ala, He says, the only people who fear Allah are the people of knowledge. And He says, the only ones who understand it are the people of knowledge. Understand it, understand the examples or the parables that are mentioned in the Quran. And Allah, He says, and they say, if we would have listened and understood, then we would not be from the companions of the blazing flame. And Allah Ta'ala, He says, are those who have knowledge equal to those who don't have knowledge? And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, He says, whoever Allah wants good for, He gives him an understanding. And indeed, knowledge is by seeking it, or the acquisition of knowledge is by seeking it. And Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, he said that if you were to place a sword on this, and he motioned to his neck, and I thought that I could narrate or propagate a word that I heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before you would have used that sword on me, then I would have done so. And Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he says, I advise you to be Rabbaniyun, Rabbaniyin, kunu Rabbaniyina hulama fuqaha. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he says, to be Rabbanis and to be wise and to be of people of understanding. And it is said that the Rabbani, he is the one who grooms or raises the people on the smaller knowledge before the bigger knowledge. This chapter of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, and this is from the beginning to the end of this chapter, there's a lot of benefits for us in this, and we hope inshallah ta'ala that it would help us understand priorities in seeking the knowledge. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he begins with his statement that knowledge is before action, statements and actions, or knowledge precedes statement, the statement and the action. And this is that Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, that he's showing that knowledge is a condition for the statement and the action to be accepted, as no statement and action will be accepted unless it's based on knowledge. Rather, that a person's niyyah or intention is not correct until it's based on knowledge, and then the actions will be based upon the niyyah afterwards, which are based on knowledge. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam shows us the importance of having a good niyyah in everything, with his statement, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ وَإِنَّمَا كُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ لِدُنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا أَوْ لِامْرَأَةٍ يَنْكِحُهَا فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. And this hadith of Bukhari and Muslim, where the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he says, actions are by intentions, and that a person only has what he intends. So whoever makes his hijra for Allah and his messenger, then his hijra is for Allah and his messenger. And whoever makes the hijra for worldly gain or for a lady to marry her, then his hijra is for what he made his hijra to. So Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he's showing here with his statement that your statements and your actions will not be accepted until they are based on knowledge, as knowledge must precede the statement and the action if it's going to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he uses as his evidence the statement of Allah ta'ala, فَعَلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. I command you to have knowledge that no God has the right to be worshipped except Allah. So Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he uses the statement of Allah, I command you to have knowledge that no God has the right to be worshipped except Allah. As Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says, Allah began with al-ilm, that Allah preceded the statement of which is the basis of our life, and this was the purpose that we were created for, to establish the statement of a tawheed, that knowledge must precede that. This is our purpose in life, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. and I have not created the jinn nor the mankind except to worship me. This was the reason that we were created to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to establish this statement, you must have knowledge as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he began with ilm in this statement. And Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he goes on as he says, indeed the prophets left knowledge as their inheritance. And Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he makes this statement, and al-Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimahullah, he said, don't misunderstand the statement of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah into thinking that this statement is not a hadith. Though the ulama, they differ to the authenticity of this hadith, whether it has been authentically reported on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or not, and some of them say it was and some of them say it's not, and this is, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, why Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he didn't say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the prophets left knowledge to be inherited from them. But the statement of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, it shows that there is some basis in this statement. And if that's not sufficient, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran makes a statement to show that this statement is based in Allah's book. As Allah ta'ala, he says, ثُمَّ أَوْرَثْنَا الْكِتَابَ الَّذِينَ اصْطَفَيْنَا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. And then we left the book to be inherited by those chosen people from our servants. So this statement is based on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's book, and that the prophets, they left knowledge to be inherited it from them. And others, they say that in fact what is meant by this statement, yarhamukallah, is that the ulama, or the people of knowledge, they are the ones who inherited the knowledge. And that is with the way that you will pronounce the word وَرَّثُ الْعِلْمِ or وَرِثُ الْعِلْمِ, with a shadda or without the shadda on it. And one would make the meaning that the prophets left knowledge to be inherited from them, and the other meaning would be that the people of knowledge inherited the knowledge. And the ulama, they say that what is most correct, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, is that the prophets left knowledge to be inherited from them. As in the narration of the same hadith from Imam al-Tirmidhi, it says, إِنَّ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ وَرَّثُ الْعِلْمِ إِنَّ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ لَمْ يُوَرِّثُوا دِينَارًا وَلَا دِرْهَمًا إِنَّمَا وَرَّثُوا الْعِلْمِ. In this narration it says that the prophets, they didn't leave any dinars or dirhams to be inherited from them, or any wealth, but they left the knowledge to be inherited from them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says, and this was also part of the hadith, the hadith is in fact authentically reported on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that whoever gets it gets a large portion, or a good portion, that whoever gets this knowledge, then he has gained a good portion, or something that will benefit him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And then Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he said, whoever treads a path seeking knowledge in that path, then Allah would make for him easy the path to Jannah. And this means that one of two things: either it will be on Yawm al-Qiyamah easy for him to enter into Jannah if he sought knowledge in this world, or it could mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it easy for him the path in this world that will lead to Jannah in the hereafter, and that is by not committing shirk and by the performance of righteous deeds. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, and whoever desires to meet his Lord and to have him, his Lord pleased with him, then let him perform righteous deeds, and let him not ascribe any partners in worship with his Lord. And this statement that Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he makes, in fact, this is the authentic hadith collected by Imam Muslim, except that in the chain there was some discussion about its authenticity, and this is why Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah didn't mention it as a hadith in his sahih, although the hadith has been in fact authentically collected on the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam by Imam Muslim, and this is also in the collection of the 40 hadith. where Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, "Man nafasa an muslimin, من نفس عن مسلم قربة من قرب الدنيا نفس الله عنه قربة من قرب يوم القيامة ومن يسر على معسر يسر الله عليه في الدنيا والآخرة ومن ستر مسلما ستره الله في الدنيا والآخرة والله في عون العبد ما كان العبد في عون أخيه ومن سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سهل الله له به طريقا إلى الجنة وما اجتمع قوم في بيت من بيوت الله يتلون كتاب الله ويتدارسونه بينهم إلا نزلت عليهم السكينة وغشيتهم الرحمة وحفتهم الملائكة وذكرهم الله في من عنده فمن بطأ به عمله لم يسرع به نسبه." In this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says that whoever removes some sadness or hardship from a believer in this world, then Allah would remove from him some grief and sorrows on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And that whoever makes it easy for the one who's having difficult times, then Allah would make it easy for him in this world and the hereafter. And that whoever hides something from a Muslim, covers up, like covers his faults, then Allah would cover it up for him on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And Allah is in the aid of his servant who is in the aid of his brother. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, and this is the statement that Imam al-Bukhari rahimullah, he mentions, that whoever treads a path seeking knowledge in that path, then Allah would make for him easy the path to Jannah. And you won't find a group of people who have combined themselves together in a house from the houses of Allah, and they are reciting the Quran and studying it amongst themselves, except that the Sakina or the tranquility will descend upon them, and they will be covered with the mercy, and the angels will encompass them, and Allah will mention them with those who are with him. And whoever is short or falls short in his practice, then his lineage won't benefit him. And this is authentically collected by Imam Muslim. And then Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says that Allah Ta'ala, he says that the only people who fear Allah are the people of knowledge. And that is, if you don't know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you can't fear him properly, because you have to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fear him. And the ignorant people, they don't estimate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a proper estimation. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself, he says, أَفَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ تَأْمُرُونِي أَعْبُدُ أَيُّهَا الْجَاهِلُونَ وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَئِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ بَلِ اللَّهَ فَاعْبُدْ وَكُنْ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ وَمَا قَدَرَ اللَّهُ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, "Is it other than Allah that you are commanding me to worship, O those who are ignorant? And it has been revealed to you, as it has been revealed to those who have come before you, that if you would have committed shirk, then your deeds will be rendered null and void, and you will be from amongst the losers. Rather, worship Allah alone and be thankful and grateful to him." And they have not given Allah his proper estimation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here, he's showing that those people who are ignorant, that they don't give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his proper estimation. And you can't fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until you know him, or till you have ilm. And this is the meaning of the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only ones who fear him are the people of knowledge. And Allah ta'ala, he says, and the only people who understand it are the people of knowledge. The only people who understand the examples that are set forth and the parables that are mentioned in the Quran, that the only people who understand it are the people of knowledge. And Imam al-Bukhari rahimullah, he's mentioning these ayat to show the virtues of knowledge and the virtues of the people of knowledge, and to be an encouragement for the people to seek this knowledge and not to belittle the seeking of the knowledge. And then Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says that Allah Ta'ala, he says, and they say, if we would have listened and understood, then we would have not been from the companions of the hellfire. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Surah al-Mulk, what he's doing is showing a scene from the scenes of Yawm al-Qiyamah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing what it will be like based on the way that people conduct themselves in this world. And he's showing here that on Yawm al-Qiyamah that there will be a group of people who will say, if we would have listened and understood, we would have not been from the people of the blazing flame. And these characteristics of listening attentively and understanding, then these are the characteristics or the qualities that the people of knowledge have. So it's as if they're saying, if we were from amongst the people of knowledge, or if we would have had knowledge, then we would have not been from the people of the blazing flame. And this is an encouragement to seek knowledge, as knowledge will save you from the hellfire, and as we saw in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it will lead you to Jannah. In Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says that Allah Ta'ala, he says, are those people who know like those people who don't know? And here this is a rhetorical question asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which really means that the people who know are not like those who don't know. Rather, the people who have knowledge are better and above those people who don't know. And these are just some ayat that Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he mentions in order to be an encouragement to seek the knowledge and to show the virtues of knowledge and the people of knowledge. And if Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he wanted to, he could have mentioned other ayat, as there are other ayat, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encourages us to seek the knowledge, the likes of the statement of Allah Ta'ala, Shahidallahu annahu la ilaha illa hu wal malaikatu wa ulul ilm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Allah bears witness that no God has the right to be worshipped except him, and the angels and the people of knowledge also bear witness to this fact. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning that to show the high place of the people of knowledge. And Allah Ta'ala, he says, وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْؤُولًا. And Allah Ta'ala, he says, and don't say what you have no knowledge of, indeed the hearing, the sight, and the intellect will all be questioned. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. For the likes of the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتٍ. So in the likes of these ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, indeed those from amongst you who believe and have been given knowledge will be raised in degrees. These are all ayat, and there are other ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encourages us to seek the knowledge, and he praises the people of knowledge. And then the Bukhari rahimahullah, he goes into some hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as he says, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, whoever Allah wants good for, he gives him an understanding. And the Sahih Bukhari, after this chapter, by about two chapters or so, Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he mentions this hadith with his chain back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the wording is, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. That whoever Allah wants good for, he gives him an understanding of this deen, or a fiqh of this deen. And some of the ulama, they say that what is meant by fiqh is an understanding. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَمَا لِهَٰؤُلَاءِ الْقَوْمِ لَا يَكَادُونَ يَفْقَهُونَ حَدِيثًا. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, and what is wrong with these people that they almost don't understand this hadith, referring to the Quran. So this word fiqh, it means an understanding, and some of the ulama, they say that also what is meant in the context of the usage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is an understanding that's also coupled with actions. And then Bukhari rahimahullah, he says, knowledge is only acquired by seeking it. And Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar explains that in fact this is authentic hadith reported on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, collected by Ibn Abi Asim in the Sunnah and Al-Tabarani. Where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Ya ayyuhal nas, ta'allamu, innama al-ilmu bit-ta'allum, wal-fiqhu bit-tafaqhuh, wa man yuridillahu bihi khayran yufaqihuhu fid-deen. The Prophet alayhi sallatu wasalam, he says, O humanity, I command you to seek knowledge, because knowledge is only acquired by seeking it, and fiqh is only gained by seeking and understanding. And whoever Allah wants good for, He gives him an understanding of this deen. And also in this hadith, the ulama, they say that this makes it clear to us that the knowledge or the ilm or the fiqh or the understanding that the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is referring to in these authentic hadith or in those ayat where Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is praising the people of knowledge and knowledge, then it's referring to knowledge of this deen, which is knowledge of Allah's book and the sunnah of His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam and other authentic hadith, he encourages us to seek knowledge with the likes of his statement, خيارهم في الجاهلية خيارهم في الإسلام إذا فقهوا. Where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam says in the hadith of Bukhari and others, the best of them in jahiliyyah are the best of them in Islam if they have a fiqh, if they have an understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's deen. Whereas the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the hadith collected by the Ashab al-Sunan, it's authentic inshaAllah ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, طَلَبُ الْعِلْمِ فَرِيضَةٌ عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ. That seeking knowledge is an obligation on every Muslim. And then Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says that Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, he says, if you were to place the sword on this, any motion to his neck, and I thought that I would get off a statement that I learned from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam before you would cut my head off, then I would have propagated that phrase from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. This statement of Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu has been authentically collected by Ad-Darimi and his Sunan rahimahullah, and he narrates on Abu Kathir Malik ibn Murtad, who narrates on the authority of his father, قال أتيت أبا ذر وهو جالس عند جمرة الوسطى قد اجتمع عليه الناس يستفتونه فأتاه رجل فوقف عليه فقال ألم تنهى عن الفتية فرفع رأسه إليه فقال أرقيم أنت علي ثم ذكر قوله رضي الله عنه. And this narration, Abu Kathir, who's Malik ibn Marthar, he narrates on the authority of his father, who said that I came to Abu Dharr while he was at the Jamratul Wusta, and this is the place there at Mina where you perform the Hajj. And the people had gathered around Abu Dharr and they were asking him Islamic questions, or they were asking him to make fatwas. So a man came up to Abu Dharr and he stood over him and he said, haven't you been prohibited from making fatwas? And this prohibition had come from the Amir al-Mu'mineen Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, because of a problem that had broke out between, or a misunderstanding that had taken place between Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. So Uthman prevented or prohibited Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu from making fatwas, and this person was reminding Abu Dharr of the statement of the Khalifa of the Muslims at that time, Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, he raised his head to the man and he said, are you a raqib over me? Are you a watcher over me and the one who holds me accountable for what I do? And then he made his statement, if you were to place that sword on my neck, and I thought that I could have propagated what I've heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam before you cut my head off, then I would have done so. And the ulama, they say that this story here with Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, it shows us that it exemplifies the position of Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, and that is that if a person of knowledge is prevented from propagating his knowledge by the leader of the Muslims, then the leader of the Muslims will not be obeyed in that case. And they said it was as if Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, what was on his mind was the statement of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that's in the hadith of al-Bukhari and others, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةٌ وحدثوا عن بني إسرائيل ولا حرج، ومن كذب علي متعمدا فليتبوأ مقعده من النار. Where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, preach about me even if it's only one ayah, and narrate on Bani Israel, and there's no problem with that. And whoever lies on me intentionally, then he has a seat prepared for him in the hellfire. As if Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, that he was aware of the obligation that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had placed on the people of knowledge of propagating the knowledge, or he was understanding the prohibition of hiding the knowledge that the people know. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says in the authentic hadith of Abu Dawood and others, من سئل عن علم فكتمه ألجمه الله بلجام من نار يوم القيامة. Or كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. Where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, whoever is asked about some knowledge and then he hides it, then he will be given a bridle of fire to wear around him on Yawm al-Qiyamah. So as if Abu Dharr was reminded of these hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which led him to his position. And the people of knowledge, they say that also benefits can be extracted from this story of Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, and that is that the people of knowledge must be patient with whatever harm and difficulties that might come to them by propagating this knowledge. And it's an encouragement for the people of knowledge to strive hard to propagate what they know from Allah's book and the Sunnah of His Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, even though they might be faced with whatever difficulties they'll be faced with in doing that. And then Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says that Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he says, I advise you to be Rabbanis and to be wise and to be people of understanding or people of fiqh. And Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he says that it's said that the Rabbani is the one who grooms the people on the smaller knowledge before the bigger knowledge. And some of the ulama, they say that there's a difference to what is the actual root word of this word Rabbani. And some of them say that the root word is from Rabb, which means Lord. And they say that the Rabbani is the one who teaches the people what their Lord wants from them. And others say, as Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he mentioned that the Rabbani is the one who grooms the people, and this is from the other word at-tarbiyah, or to educate or to groom the people upon the smaller knowledge before the bigger knowledge. And they say that the smaller knowledge is those affairs that are basic and simple and easily understood from this deen before you get into the more intricate and detailed affairs of this deen. And this is a basic explanation of which the ulama used for this chapter of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah in his Sahih. And there is one last benefit that I wanted to point out that we would extract from this chapter of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, and that's the application of the manhaj of our Salaf al-Salih in this chapter. As our manhaj is adherence to Allah's book and the Sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and following the way of the Sahaba and the scholars of this deen. And we see Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah that his chapter, it's based on the statements in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's book as he quotes them, and then he quotes from the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that which has been clearly authentically reported on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and even he quoted some of those statements which are a discussion from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, whether they have been authentically reported on him or not. And then Imam al-Bukhari rahimullah, he quotes the statements of the Sahaba radwanullahi ta'ala alayhim, and then after that he quotes the statements of the people of knowledge, as he said, it's said that the Rabbani means the one who grooms the people on the small knowledge before the large knowledge. It is said, meaning this is the position of the people of knowledge concerning the Rabbani. And maybe I should have added the statement of Ibn al-A'rabi, who says that a Rabbani, or that a person of knowledge, would not be Rabbani until he has knowledge, and he teaches his knowledge and he practices the knowledge that he teaches. So Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, in this chapter, he shows us how to apply this manhaj of a Salafi in the different issues of this deed, as he rahimahullah, with this chapter, knowledge precedes statement and action. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he bases this chapter with ayat and hadith and statements of the Sahaba and statements of the ulama. And this is the manhaj of our Salaf al-Salih, and this is the manhaj or the methodology that we should be upon in our aqidah and in our statements and in our acts of worship or in our mu'amalat, our interactions with one another or business transactions, that it must be based on the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with the understanding of our Sahaba and then the scholars of this deen. This is what I wanted to present. الله سبحانه وتعالى نوز بس هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين
جزاك الله خير There is no microphone over here
نعم
JazakAllah khair for this talk. The first question that we have here says Surah An-Nisa, ayah number 59, which is وَمَنْ يُطِعَ اللَّهَ. It says here the ayah أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. The question is, who are the real inheritors of the book Al, I cannot make up what it says here. Maybe you could.
What? I think they say Ulul Amir.
Al Ulul Amir? I don't know. And is this station a divine appointment office or secular position election?
The ulama from the Sahaba of the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam and those after them, they explained that the ulul amri minkum, it is the umara and the ulama. It is the leaders and the people of knowledge. The leaders meaning the administrative leaders from amongst the Muslims, or the leaders of countries or cities or what have you, and the people of knowledge on the different levels that they are on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
So those ulul amr, they're not a divine appointment?
I don't know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Abu Muslima, we know or should know that coming to the conference and attending classes at the masjid is a part of our seeking knowledge. But can you give myself and the brothers here some advice on how to have a method of studying outside the formal classes? I know that the way one person may study is different than another person, but if you could give a general direction.
No. I asked a similar question to one of the people I respect of knowledge, and he advised me it's better to read one book three times instead of reading three books one time. And this means that whatever you study, you must go over it and over it and over it so that it sticks with you. Otherwise, you might be like the one that one of the other people of knowledge that I respect, he said, the one who forgot is like the one who never knew in the first place. Like if you ask him about some knowledge and he says, I forgot. And if you ask someone who didn't know and he would say, I don't know. And you will get the same answer, nothing. So whatever you learn, you must review and to go over. And also, one of the people of knowledge had advised me with a similar question. He said, it's good to read three different books on the same topic. from three different authors, so that you could get a better and clearer explanation, as every author is going to have his own style and his own type of presentation. And when you hear different presentations and styles on the same subject, then it like increases or makes firmer your understanding of that particular topic. And this is the advice I have to offer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Could you please let us know what you know about the standing of as-salaf and ilm ladunni?
I forgot about that. So I don't know. Allah knows best. I'm quite sure one of the ulama, inshallah, they'll be able to answer that question.
I have a question, if I may.
Inshallah.
Is it possible that the statement of Abu Dharr that he was forbidden from making fatwa, but his statement was saying he's only propagating what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said without... Is it possible for us to have this reconciliation?
Say that one more time.
That he was forbidden from making fatwa, but when he was talking to the people, he was not actually making fatwa. He was just relaying to the people what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said. Therefore, he said to the person, "Are you a raqib?" Is it possible for us to have this understanding?
For us to have what understanding?
That Abu Dharr was not making fatwa, but he was only saying the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Sometimes it's hard to express the meaning of the word fatwa, as oftentimes we understand it to mean a verdict without any statements from Allah's book or the sunnah of his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in this case, Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, he said that he was just narrating from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and not making a fatwa. And this is also, a fatwa is to answer questions or to give answers to questions based on the deen. And oftentimes those answers will be straight ayat and hadith from the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then other times it will be an explanation of ayat and hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because some questions might take into consideration a group of ayat and not just one, or a group of hadith and not one, or a group of ayat and hadith and not just one ayat or one hadith. And even other times things will be extracted from a text of which are general statements of the Messenger of Allah, general statements of Allah or the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and things will be extracted with the likes of, if you want to call this an example, a fatwa: is crack permissible? No, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited crack with his statement in the hadith of Imam Muslim: kullu muskirin khamrun wa kullu khamrin haram. Every intoxicant is khamr and every khamr is haram. Does crack intoxicate? Yes. Then it's khamr and every khamr is haram. This is like a general statement. I hope this is clarification. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
Can you get the knowledge from books, or is it only possible to get it from the ulama?
I hope the person who wrote that question understands what he's saying as he says it. Who are the books written by? Is it only, are we only able to acquire knowledge through book? Are we able to get knowledge by books, or only through the ulama? The ulama, they pass their knowledge on to us by saying it verbally and also by writing books. How are we going to get the knowledge of Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, and Sahih al-Bukhari? He wrote it, and then it's been passed on. So we get knowledge both ways, by the people of knowledge speaking directly
and by way of their books. And then if clarification is needed, then clarification is needed, whether it's by the person of knowledge speaking. If he said something and you don't understand, then you have to question him. And likewise, if he read something that you don't understand, then you have to question. So the question is still going to be there, whether you hear him directly or you read from the book. What's not clear will have to be clarified. And nowadays, alhamdulillah, as many of the books have been revised, it's as if you have questions being answered in the books. As nowadays, in many of the books, it quotes a hadith, then in a footnote, it'll say, collected by Abu Dawood, and it's authentic. So when that hadith is quoted, your first statement is, who collected the hadith? And what's the authenticity of it? And then that answer is in the footnote. It's collected by Abu Dawood, and it's authentic. And likewise, too, you have the glossaries in many of the books. When you read, what does that word mean? Like the word manhaj, for example. What does it mean? Then you look in the glossary, it might give you a translation. Manhaj means methodology, for example. And then this is like you asking the question, and your question is being answered. And many of the books nowadays, alhamdulillah, in Arabic and in English, that they have this nice format where your questions are being answered. And even the question like, can you say that one more time? As they have many indexes. So you look to the index, or the table of contents, and you say, repeat that chapter again. Like you read the book one time, and you want to hear it again. But you want to hear a certain part. Again, can you repeat that part of them? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
Maybe a person who asked this question had in mind that the people who wrote the book also said the one who depends on seeking knowledge from seeking book, from reading books, is the one who has the shaytan to be his sheikh. مَنْ كَانَ كِتَابُهُ شَيْخُهُ فَإِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ شَيْخُهُ فَمَنْ أَخَذَ الْعِلْمَ عَنْ غَيْرِ شَيْخٍ ضَلَّ عَنَ الصِّرَاطِ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Maybe this is what they're referring to, because many a time people read books and they get their own understanding, but being a student under a sheikh will refine that individual. Maybe that was the meaning of the question.
I don't know how to answer except with the answer that I just mentioned, except that I might say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. Read in the name of your Lord who created. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to read, and this is one of the ways of acquiring and seeking knowledge, and there's no escape from it. Even if the sheikh teaches you, you're going to have to write down what the sheikh teaches you, and it's going to be in book form then, and then you're going to review. The issue, as we're saying before, there's no escape from the question. And the issue of misunderstanding something that you read or you heard, the possibility is there, and it can be, inshallah ta'ala, alleviated with one of two ways: either with the questioning one way, or with the revision in another way. As you review together, as we are reading in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that they're reciting the Quran and they're studying it amongst themselves. What you understand, you're going to give back to the sheikh or to the other students in the class. Oh, you remember when the sheikh was saying such and such? You say, yes, I remember he said it, but he didn't mean it like that, he meant it like this. And if you study together amongst yourselves, or with the sheikh, and he hears, or like he gives you a test or whatever, and you present the information back to him, then it will be clarified if you understood what he meant or you didn't understand what he meant. But that possibility is both in reading and in listening. And it could be alleviated with either the question, I'm not sure that this means that, or it doesn't seem like this should mean that, and then you ask the question, or you're just reviewing with one another, well, this means this, that means that, and then someone will say, no, it doesn't mean that, it means this. Well, I thought it meant that. Yeah, I thought the same thing before it was cleared up to me, that in fact it means such and such. So there's no escape. And we have to take the means that are available, whether it's in book form or it's in actual lecture form, with the people of knowledge teaching us directly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
Is smoking haram? Are there any specific hadith, sunnah, ayat that state directly or indirectly that it is?
Yes. Many of the ulama, they say smoking is haram, and there are texts that indirectly mention smoking to be haram. with the likes of the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَائِفِ, and He makes the filthy things haram for them, meaning the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam. And cigarette smoking is filthy and dirty, and likewise because of it, it becomes haram. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. There was a book written by Ali Hassan al-Halabi, and we had translated this book on the prohibition of smoking cigarettes. And he had even mentioned that some of the European countries had made cigarette smoking banned and forbidden in their countries, that even the kuffar knew that cigarette smoking is no good, and the Muslims have more right with guidance from Allah's book, with some of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to know that this has no place in the life of a Muslim. Allah knows best.
Please give us some advice regarding the etiquette of being amongst the people of ilm.
Maybe one of the people of ilm, inshallah ta'ala, that are here, they might be able to better answer that question. I don't know. Allah knows best.
There's no more question. We conclude this session, inshallah. Jazakum Allahu khair for your listening, and jazallah Abu Sheikh Abu Muslima khair for his topic and for his talk. Wa hadha wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.
Inshallah.